I just thank God today for being a God. We ask you to open up our standards. We open up your word in the precious name of Christ Jesus. Amen. Acts chapter 17 and verse number 28. Amen. Yes, God. Let's go to the word of God. Are we there yet? I'm getting there. I'm almost there. Acts chapter number 17 and verse number 28. And the word of God basically reads as follows. And I'm right there right now. And verse 28 says, "For in him we live and move and have our being. And certain ourselves, your own poets have said, for we are all his offsprings." Amen. See, this is Paul talking to these people that's in chapter 17. These are Gentiles, and he's talking to them, to these Greeks in Acts chapter 17, and he began to show them, it's in him we live, we move, we have our being. So everything you got comes from God. Whether or not you saved or unsaved, everything you got comes from God. See, the thing about the church, we know it comes from God. But the thing about the world don't know it came from God. The house that you got is God that gave you the power to get that house. The wife that you got is God that gave you that wife. The children that you got, oh, praise the Lord. It is God that let them break the matrix and come into this world. It is all from God. Everything you got came from God. And some of us look back and they content. We're not content, we're not satisfied, we're not appreciative of what God has already done for us. If you ain't appreciating what God has already done for you, if he ain't done nothing for you, he's just saved you and sanctified you and filled you with the baptism of the Holy Ghost. Ain't that enough? If he don't do nothing else for you except save you, sanctify you, fill you with the baptism of the Holy Ghost. If you're living right, walking right, talking right, not doing right, ain't that enough? Well, President, what else do you want? In the process of being appreciative of where you are, God is able to bless you with more. But if you're never content where you are, it's hard for God to bless you with more. You can't even handle what you got. You ain't even appreciate what you got. Let's go to the word of God. Deuteronomy chapter number 8 and verse number 11 through 18. Amen. And I feel sorry for the people that don't have this revelation. I feel sorry for those people that think it's all because of their goodness, all because of their intelligence, all because of their hustling, all because of their bustling, all because of their working. Praise the Lord. God showed me a revelation. We're trying to work hard for things that God want to give us. We're killing ourselves working for things that God want to give to us anyway. Let's go. I'm going to show you in the book. Y'all name them. Deuteronomy chapter 8 and verse number 11. See, some things come from the hand of God. And those people that God is going to bless to be prosperous, it ain't going to necessarily come because you work for it. It ain't necessarily going to be, oh my. Now, see, the Bible says the people of God are talking to the people of God. He's talking to the people. He said, beware now. Beware now. Forget not the Lord thy God in what? In not keeping his commandments and his judgment and his statutes which I command this day. Least when thou hast what? Eaten and art full, and has built goodly houses and dwelt therein, and when I heard, and thy flock multiplied, and the silver and thy gold be multiplied, and all that thou hast is multiplied, and I know, oh, Shango, I believe prosperity is coming to this house in the process of time. And y'all know ain't no prosperity preacher, but some of y'all gonna have some change in your life. I don't wanna sit no time, but some of y'all gonna be very successful, some of y'all gonna be very wealthy in the process of time. But in the meantime, you gotta serve God. In the meantime, you gotta live holy. And I ain't talking about just one, person in here. God is gonna rain on several people in now. I ain't no talking about he gonna make you mean. I don't know about all that kind of stuff. But I know God is gonna bless you, that you're gonna be successful. You're gonna be prosperous in what you put your, if you just live holy, walk holy, talk holy, prosperity is coming your way. And see what the Bible says. Least when they have eaten and are full and have built goodly houses and dwelt there and houses coming too. And when they have heard and flock and multiply, and the still is multiplied, and all that thou hast is multiplied. Then thy heart be lifted up, and thou forget the God which brought thee forth out of the land of Egypt from a house of bondage. Somebody gonna get a few. When God bless you with this stuff, don't get the big head. Everybody say, don't get the big head. Don't stop coming to church. Don't stop living holy. Don't go in that closet and get you all that rubbish stuff and get them pants that you're gonna do. want it right now. He ain't gonna give it to you right now. You ain't ready for it right now. Let's go to the book. And that heart be lifted up, and thou forget the Lord thy God, which brought thee forth out of the land of Egypt, from the house of bondage, who led thee through the great and the terrible wilderness, when were fiery serpents and scorpions and drought, where there was no water, who brought thee forth water out of a rock of flint, who fed thee in the wilderness with manna, which thy father knew not, that he might humble thee. Oh my goodness, Jesus. Some things we're going through because God is getting ready to bless us. But before the blessing comes, the humiliation gotta come. The humbling gotta come. The frustration gotta come. Sometimes you wanna give up, and then all of a sudden you're gonna look up and the blessing is right in your face. Sometimes you wanna throw in the towel, and then all of a sudden you look up, your breakthrough is right on the way in the process of time. And the Bible say the humbling and the downright is proving, and that he might prove him to do thee good at the latter end. I'd rather have my blessing at the end. Oh, don't give me my blessing when I first start out. Oh my God, I thank God. Shando the corner. I'm not here. I thank God for my wife over here, but I thank God that he didn't give it to me when I first started serving God. No. I appreciate that he didn't give my wife to me before when I first started serving God. I may have not learned how to appreciate a woman of God like that. Mind off of a man. You need to get your mind on Jesus. I said it and I didn't stutter. Some of y'all ain't gonna give no wife right now. You ain't gotta get your mind off that woman and get your mind on Jesus. Don't put focus on Jesus. And the price of the time, God is gonna bless you with a hug. In the price of the time, God is gonna bless you with a hug. Get your mind on Jesus. When God blessed me with Sister John, I was not even looking for a wife. On my job, and there she go, walking up down the hallway. Hallelujah. I said, what in the world is that? Looky here. What church you go to, child? I was not, at that time in my life, I was not even trying to pick up no one on my job. I worked with none but ladies, man. I was not interested in dating nobody I worked with. But I saw that she was dressing holy. I saw that she was walking holy. I saw that she was living holy. I gave her my card. She tore it up through a treasure. But the Holy Ghost, a friend warned. Friend that coming in, the Holy Ghost had a friend when he made to get that number out of the trash can. Amen. Yes, Lord. Amen. Let's go to the room. But see, God blessed me with that. I'm listening to scripture. And the doubt said in our heart, my power and my might. And the might of my hand has got me this wealth. Now, wealth ain't always money. Wealth can be your health. Wealth can be your right mind. Oh, praise the Lord. Sometimes some of us would be out of our mind if it wasn't for Jesus. If it wasn't for Jesus, we wouldn't know our right hand from the left if it wasn't for Jesus. Wealth could be what? Your children. Wealth could be your call, your position in Christ. That's what wealth is. It ain't always money. It ain't always material possession. But God, you can't say it in your heart. It's by your own power you got this wealth. Some of y'all can't see your bliss. Because you're looking for money and you don't see the other stuff. Listen to me. I wouldn't trade one of my, not a single one of my children for $1 million, for $10 million. I wouldn't trade one of them children for one. So to me, that's worth more than money. Children are unhappy to the Lord. Ain't that what the Bible says? And a fool of the Lord is his reward. So no amount of money replace the wealth that God has put on that first or second row. No amount of money. No amount of money. Listen to me. That's wealth. That's blessing. That's inheritance. Oh my goodness, God began to show me about an inheritance. Everybody wants. You be careful when somebody prophesies you're going to have an inheritance. I'm going to bust this bubble right now, because some people want to say, they want to hear that prophecy. I see that the Lord is going to bless you with an inheritance. But God showed me a long time ago. God knows about the last couple 6 months. God showed me a long time ago, about 6 months, 8 months ago. You can't get an inheritance unless somebody died. See, the only way to get an inheritance is if somebody dies. Well, baby, some inheritance you don't want right now. Some inheritance, some money you don't want right now. You don't want this person to die. You don't want to, never want to be paying. God, give me an inheritance. Stop begging for it. You're begging for somebody to die. Inheritance means something that is not to you from somebody that is dead. So stop walking around praying to somebody. Prophesy over your life. God is going to bless you with an inheritance. When they prophesy that over your life, you need to go somewhere and start crying. You need to go somewhere and start weeping, because somebody got to die for you to get that inheritance. Yeah, man, change your opinion of inheritance, don't you? You see people talking about God, go give a hand, they start running around the church. Woo, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Really? 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 Let's go back to the book. But thou shalt remember that the Lord thy God, for it is he that giveth thee power to get wealth, that he may establish his covenant which he swore unto thy fathers, as it is this day. Please stop wanting to be rich. Please stop wanting to suffer. Your day is coming. Don't get anxious for it. Your day is coming. Your blessing is on the way. Focus on Jesus. You single women and you single men, get your mind off somebody else. Well, somebody, God bless them with a husband. God bless them with a wife. God, get your mind on Jesus. Your turn is coming. Your turn is coming. He is a just God. What he done for somebody else, he will do for you. You just focus on Jesus. Amen. Amen. Daniel chapter 4 and verse number 23. We're not going to read all of that, but it's just Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon. God had blessed him to be over all these countries and nations. He was lifted up in pride. Let's go there real quick and read this verse. I got to read it because I want y'all to see that God had blessed him there. He was over everything. But he lost it all. He lost it all. See, you got to understand, the Lord said, Lord, please don't destroy my house. Lord, don't destroy my house. See, we get the big head, and we think it's all because of our intelligence. No, don't get the big head. And the Bible said in verse 25, verse 24, then he had a dream about having a big tree and all the branches and all the birds of the air and all these things was lodging in that big old tree. That was him. And this is the interpretation of O king, this is Dan giving an interpretation, verse 24. And this is the decree of the Most High, which has come upon my Lord the King. And they shall drive thee from men, and thy dwelling shall be with the beasts of the field, and they shall make thee to eat grass as an ox. And they shall wet thee with the dew of the heavens, and 7 times shall pass over thee, till thou knowest that the Most High ruled in the kingdom of men and given it to whomsoever he willed. In other words, King, you ain't got nothing. Verse 26. And whereas thou commanded him to what? To lead a stump of the tree roots, thy kingdom shall be sure unto thee, after thou shalt have known that the heavens do rule. Amen. So Daniel began to beg the king to repent. What about King? Let my counsel be acceptable unto thee, and break out thy sin. Hold on. In other words, warn and come and go to trouble. Stop sinning and do right. Thy righteousness, sin thy righteousness, and thy iniquity by what? Showing mercy to the poor. If it may be what? A lifting of thy tranquility. Amen. Verse 28. And all came upon the king, Nebuchadnezzar, at the end of 12 months. He walked in the palace of the kingdom of Babylon. At that time, the greatest kingdom on earth. And the king spake and said, is not this great king, this great Babylon, that I, and it's not Sinu, that I have built from the house, for the house of the kingdom by the might of my power and for the honor of my majesty. Everything is about the king. Whenever you get, oh my goodness, God begin to show. Whenever people are always talking about them, whenever people so fixated on them, this is my this, this is my that, this is my this, this is my that, they're getting ready to fall. See what's going to happen to this wonderful king. While the word was in his mouth, was in the king's mouth, there fell a voice from heaven saying, O King Nebuchadnezzar, to thee it is spoken, thy kingdom is departed from thee. And he went crazy. You know, I don't see say he went crazy, but the interpretation of that is that he lost his mind for about 5 years, maybe 7 years. This man was out of his mind for all them years. He claws like a bird or eagle, something like that. He claws. He was on the ground and he ate all kind of stuff. He went crazy, lost his mind. But when he came to a sense, he realized, he realized the Most High rule on high. And God allowed him to get his right mind. God allowed y'all to get out of sin. He put you back in your right mind. You need to run like you're crazy. Run like a shadow. You can be running around the church, in the church every time the door's open, because God restored your mind. God restored your vision. God restored your purpose. You ain't got no business looking back no more. Amen. Job, chapter, Psalm chapter 139, verse number 12 and 16. How many of y'all like what y'all see in the mirror? Look in the mirror very good. See somebody saying, mirror, mirror on the wall, who's the fairest of them all? Especially if you're dressed in your Sunday go to meet clothes. Woo! Some people can't get out that mirror. See what the Bible says. For thou hast possessed my ruins. Psalms 139, verse 13, 12. No, let's start with verse 12. Psalm 139 and verse 12. Yea, the darkness hath not from thee, but night shineth as the day, and the darkness as a light unto are both a light to thee. For thou hast possessed my loins that has covered me in my mother's womb. I will praise thee, O Lord, for I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Marvelous are thy works, and that my soul knoweth right well. My substance was not hid from thee when I was made in secret, and curiously wrought in the lower parts of the earth. Thine eyes to see my substance, yet being unperfected or unformed. And the book, all my members was written, which in continuous were fashioned, when as yet there was none of them. Before you was born, before conception took place, God already knew how you were going to look. He knew how you were going to look. He knew how you were going to look, how tall you was going to be. He knew what color your eyes were going to be. He always, see, this is the type of God we serve. He knew all of that before you even came here. And some of us got the audacity to think we look all that. Baby, the only reason why you look all of that is because of God. I've seen beautiful people that God allowed to be beautiful physically, and they don't know their right hand from their left. Somebody got to lead them by the hand. It's all because your intelligence, your knowledge that God, that came from God. Now that didn't come from your mama. That didn't come from your pedigree. That didn't come from your family tree. Oh, praise the Lord. Have y'all ever seen someone that they look real, real nice and they got average looking parents? But they look like a 10 and their parents look like a 5 or 6 or 7. See, I'm just saying, that came from God. So you can't glory in yourself because that came from God. It didn't come from your grandmama. It didn't come from your granddad. Somebody said, oh, yes, I did, Pastor. No, you didn't. The Lord help you. Y'all think I'm joking? Everything we got comes from God. Everything we got comes from the Lord. Acts chapter 17, verse 20 says, it's in him we live, we move, we have our being. Your breath that you breathe comes from God. Your thoughts that you think come allow God allows it. In him we live, we move. If God say don't breathe, you ain't gonna breathe. Man. I mean, good help. I've heard of marathon runners falling dead of heart attacks. Has anybody heard of that? Athletes, physically fit better than anybody else. They take that physically fit body to the grave with them. Because God allowed breath to be taken from them. See, we play with God. You don't understand, everything comes from God. Let's wrap this up. Job chapter 1, verse number 8 to 13. See, if the Lord would move the hedge, I believe that's a hedge around some of us. I believe God's allowed protection to be around some of us. Mm-mm, it came from God, baby. Protection comes from God. He allowed protection to come from God. I got the devil under my feet because God allowed. Holy Ghost is holding them down, Lord. You got that right. Because it's sure ain't you. Y'all don't think I'm joking. It is God's grace and mercy. Job chapter 1 and verse 8. Now the devil, the father lied, but I believe the devil may have had this right. What? The devil may have had this right. Job chapter 1 and verse 8. And the Lord said unto Satan, hast thou considered my servant Job, that there is none like him in the earth? A perfect man. A perfect and an upright man. One that feared God and stood evil. Then Satan answered the Lord and said, does Job fear God for naught? Now this is the devil talking to God. Has thou not made an hedge about him and about his house and about all that he has on every side? Thou hast blessed the works of his hands, and his substance is increased in the land. Don't that sound like Deuteronomy chapter 8? So the devil may have actually been telling the truth right now. The father of lies may actually have been telling the truth. So some of us, instead of getting the big head, we need to say, Lord, please don't move that hedge. Amen. And it's amazing because this is the devil talking to God. And the Lord did not rebuke the devil. Amen. Wait a minute. When the devil came to Jesus and told Jesus, did that, Jesus said, he said, get you behind me, Satan. No, but the Lord ain't rebuking the devil ready. It might just be true. But put verse 11. But put forth thy hand now and touch all that he had, and he will curse thee to the face. That's a lie. And the Lord said unto Satan, behold, all that he had is in thy power. Only upon himself put not forth thy hand. So Satan went forth from the presence of the Lord with permission from God. He allowed. See, saints, you got to stop getting big head. Somebody got a big head around and thinking it's all about your prayers. We appreciate your prayers. It's all about your fasting. We appreciate your fasting too. And the Lord too. But it ain't all about your fasting. It ain't all about how much word you know. How many times you read this Bible. Some of this is all because of Jesus. It's because of Jesus. I'm just saying. And at any moment he can stop. It scared me. It put the fear of God in me to know that that man that I went to high school with fell dead of heart attack, had strokes, and left this earth. Gone. I mean, they gone. And I'm still here. There must be a reason. Amen. Luke chapter number 12, verse number 14. I'm trying to wrap it up. But I want us to know, say, look, we need to pray that. No. I'm picking up something in the spirit that I don't like it, and the Lord don't like it. And the Lord said, you know you're appreciative, but you're not appreciative enough. He know you're thankful, but you're not thankful enough. You give an outward accolade, but in your heart there's things that need to be dealt with. And any moment it can be taken away. Amen. Luke chapter 12, verse 4. And I say unto you, my friend, be not afraid of them which killeth the body. After that they have what? No more power than they can do. They can kill your body. He said, don't be afraid of them. Wait a minute. You supposed to be afraid of the gun, the robber, the bugger, the one that can take you out of here, the gang banger that can shoot you and blow your brains out. That's what Jesus said. He said what? But I say unto you, my friend said, he says, fear not, verse number 5, but I will forewarn you whom ye shall fear. Fear him which after he hath killed has power to cast in the hell. Yea, I say unto you, fear him. There's only one person that can kill you and have power to cast you in the hell. His name is God. Amen. Name is Jesus. He's got power to cast you in the hell after he's killed your body. He said you need to fear him. I don't care whether or not you're saved or unsaved. You better give God his reverential fear. And I'm telling some of you teenagers here, some of y'all really don't fear God. You think it's a joke. You better start fearing God. You better start referencing God. Because he got power to cast you into hell and to bring up all them sermons that you heard when you sit back in the house of God and laugh and sniggle and giggle when the word of God was coming. He got power to cast you into hell. That's the person you need to fear. And I'm not trying to scare you. It's just a fact. Amen. And verse 6. Are not 5 sparrows sold for what? 2 farthings. And not one of them is given for God before God. Wait a minute. God take the time to think to consider these little birds that we might catch in the net and we see them. And God see them. See, we think God didn't pay no attention. He saw that little bird you caught in the net and you saw it. A God that is so great that looking at stuff like that. What kind of God is this? And they ain't even all. But even the very hairs of your head are all numbered. Do you understand what's going on? This God see everything that you do. This God know your thoughts before they even come forth. This God know what you're doing in private. This God know what you're doing in public. This God know what you're planning to do next week. This God see all of that. The very hairs of your head are numbered. Has anybody there ever took the time to try to number your hair? I have not even taken the time to try to number my couple of hairs on my head. And they ain't as much as most of y'all got in here. It seems funny though. But does God take that care of such minute stuff that we think is a joke? He know all about you. And some of y'all are afraid to give your life to him. He know whether or not you're going to die of cancer. He know whether or not you're going to die of heart attack. He know whether or not you're going to die of car wreck. He got power to change all of that. Amen. But still, we play with God. Amen. If I were you, I wouldn't. Amen. I would think before I do certain things. Amen? Amen. But even the hairs of your head are all numbered. Fear not, therefore, you are what? Of much more value. There are many sparrows. James chapter 4, we're done. Verse 13 to 15. Minister, remember, can you read this from James chapter 4, verse number 13 to 15. We're done for today with the scriptures. Amen. But I believe God is calling somebody today. And they think, well, I'm not ready. Let me let you know something. You think you're not ready. But the Lord knows it's your season. It's your time. It's your season. It's your time to get it right. James chapter 4, verse 13, minister. James chapter 4, and verse number 13, sir. Whenever you get there, please say amen. We're done. James chapter 4, and verse 13.
The Bible says, go now, ye that say tomorrow, today or tomorrow, we will go into such a city and continue there a year and buy and sell and get gain. Whereas ye know not what shall be on tomorrow, for what is your life? It is a vapor that appears for a little time and then vanishes away.
Wait. Your life that you put so much value in is a vapor. I mean, don't that humble us? Your little life that you value so much is a vapor. That's scary. We think we mean something. We appreciate who we are. We put so much emphasis on ourselves. We ain't nothing but a family. Please read.
But that ye ought to say, if the Lord will, we shall live and do this or that. But now you rejoice in your boasting. All such rejoicing is evil. Therefore, to him that knoweth to do good and doeth it not, to him it is a sin.
All his Bible, all eyes closed. Somebody say, Lord, please don't destroy my house. My little baby, my little children, my wife, my family, my job. Everything that I hold dear is because of you, Jesus. Please don't destroy my house, Lord. Please, Jesus. Anybody you pray today, come forth in prayer. Anyone, anything. Pray for anything, anything. Come on. Come for prayer today. Come for prayer. Somebody need to repent. Come to God and say, Lord, forgive me of all my sins. Lord, save me and fill me with the baptism of the Holy Ghost. Lord, save me. Lord, save me. Lord, fill me. Change my mind. Lord, ministers, come forth. Ministers, come forth. Ministers. Anybody need prayer today, please come forth.